somewhere in my mind that I should work on this, you know, breaking this myth that is surrounding the, you know, disability area. Many are spaces, public spaces, social spaces doesn't have disabled friendly.
So what is the reality of women's safety at workplace?
Women are not only physically harassed.
Ability.
My ability is not having this in my ability.
Welcome to ICT Academy Dialogue. Today we have Raghavi Senthil Kumar, an HR consultant, trainer, educationist, Posh ICC member, motivational and public speaker, who is also the founder of the Headway Foundation that builds capacity of differently abled people. Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for giving me this opportunity to connect to people through ICT, and special thanks to you. Thank you.
Yeah, welcome. And your profile, as I was going through your profile, it hinted me a lot of things, and it almost took me half a day to completely understand your profile, because you have been doing a lot of things, and you are much acclaimed for each of your endeavors, and that's very astonishing to see. What are you other than the founder of the Headway Foundation?
Founder of Headway Foundation has been very recent, actually.
Okay.
My career is into HR. I'm okay. A passionate human resource person, and my flair was into HR, and that's how I picked HR as a profession. Throughout my career, I've been, you know, working on with people, being myself as a human resource professional, and my flair totally, you know, narrowed down to training as such.
Mm.
So after, you know, I took up training as another passion of mine, my scope of work actually enlarged. That's when I was actually, I had my babies at the time, and then I had to, you know, work on a multifaceted basis, at the same time flexi basis. I started, you know, mentoring people on various areas under the management, perspective per se. And I started talking in various forums as a speaker, as a public speaker, as a motivational speaker. And I started my Headway Academy, which focuses on the transformation of people's, you know, current mindsets, which is more of a elevated version of your training and development as such. Then, worked on the prevention of sexual harassment, concept, and I'm also ICC member in various organizations.
Okay.
So these are the multifacets apart from the Headway Foundation as such. Headway Foundation, it is somewhere inside my heart, which was born, which was conceived and brought out as a matter of breaking the stereotypes, I would say. This is totally another parallel division of mine, where my passion was into HR, and this has been somewhere in my mind that I should work on this, breaking this myth that is surrounding the, disability area. So slowly I was working on, the employment opportunities for the differently abled people, which was there in my mind, but, you propose something and God proposes something else. It was merely an opportunity that I worked with, differently abled people's recruitment part. And that's how my focus on this Headway Foundation started.
Okay. So today, Headway Foundation completely is into capacity building for differently abled people, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Headway Foundation is a 2+ year old organization, which focuses on the empowerment of differently abled people through various forms, through education, through employment, through capacity building, through advocating on various areas, in terms of reasonable accommodation. Many are spaces, public spaces, social spaces doesn't have disabled friendly, so-called wheelchair friendly, and all that. So advocating on such parts, you know, empowering the livelihood of differently abled people, promoting the artistic differently abled people also. Mm-hmm. And we're also focusing on the sport part, you know, the differently abled sport players. So there are many elements that we focus on in terms of inclusion of differently abled people in the society. Mm-hmm. And our motto is to build an inclusive India, you know, by our caption is like, let's together build an inclusive India.
Okay. So when coming to empowering people, particularly the differently abled, whether you reach people or people reach you, how do they find
beautiful it? Question. Actually, it is either way. I wouldn't say just the differently abled people because I would say all the you know, the resources, human resources of the society are one. Okay, so I wanted to connect not only with the differently abled people but also the able-bodied people who can support them.
Yeah.
So that is what is inclusion, right? So this mismatch was always there. This is a differently abled community was like somewhere isolated all this while, and I wanted to really bridge. Though there were many interventions, initiativeness taken by many people to work on this disability area, inclusion, equal opportunity, and all that. But I feel, you know, it's my responsibility that I should take a call on this, and that's how I started working on that, and people started knowing me. Many differently abled people started knowing me, and I connect with them and people connect with me. It's either way. And I think I should thank social media on this. I think I should thank all these, you know, so-called these social media handles as such that we, you know, use. And I think only through these modes we are reaching out to various people. And many things happen only through the social media. So this is how it is.
As you talk about inclusivity in terms of having differently abled people included in the society, in the mainstream society, what should be the responsibility of the abled people to accommodate differently abled?
Yes, this is what is the need for the hour. That's what I would say. There are three types of people. One, people know the pain, the challenges, the struggles that a differently abled person undergo, and they support them, they empower them. So that is one kind of people. Another kind of people, they don't know completely. Okay, they don't know their unless and until they are on their shoes, they don't know what's happening. They can't even understand, you know, when a wheelchair person you know, comes in, they'll have to, you know, kind of assist you know, by at least opening the door, a few basic gestures, I would say. So they don't even know. Number three would be people, they are wanting to help but they don't know how to do. So these are the three categories that I would say. Yes, first category people are there, and that is how many people are getting empowered, and that is how many we are connecting with so many such people, and we are able to do certain initiatives with them. I will come to the third category of people that I said. These people are really, you know, wanting to create a better India. So they want to, you know, change certain lives. Like, you know, we had so many social initiatives in Chennai city, and there are many initiatives coming up, you know, to break such problems also. So such way, these people are there to support, to lend their hand, so that we reach out to them, they will, you know, support you. The second category of people that I told, they are busy with their own career, their own family, their own, you know, set of protocols that they have. Nothing wrong. But I think when we kind of encounter them, it is difficult for us to actually, you know, mingle with the society. Say, for example, people don't know how to handle a visually impaired person. So the second category of people, they don't attempt to understand the differently abled people because that is not under their scope. So when we have such a cumulative kind categories of people, I think it is about understanding each other. Do we know if a neighbor, you know, who is beside our house is a differently abled person? Don't know, because we refrain ourselves from mingling with people.
Yeah.
And in that case, when it is differently abled people who actually need some hands to, you know, lift them, I think this is where the bridge is. And that is why we organize a lot of events, a lot of forums, a lot of initiatives in terms of, you know, bringing about this awareness to the general public, do a lot of campaigns. So this is completely a social initiative where we want differently abled people to be included. So such awareness programs also we organize so that, you know, people understand each other, and a lot of sensitivity training programs that we do in terms of understanding the differently abled co-employees, where the peers need to understand them.
Okay.
So these are various initiatives that, you know, we do, and a lot more to come.
Thanks for your brilliant answers on how to make able-bodied people to accommodate differently abled. And being an HR person, it teases me to ask you this question. Which part of being an HR is very difficult? To recruit people or to retain people?
Yeah, both are the most challenging part of the HR.
Okay.
Recruitment, you know, bringing the right talent into the organization is one wonderful thing, at the same time the most responsible thing, I would say. A person fitting into the job, the role, is very important.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, retaining that talent is very important. In this particular scenario, jobs are kind of diminishing and retention levels are increasing. This is what is the current trend news that we keep hearing.
Okay.
Though artificial intelligence in this VUCA world, you know, many things are changing and all that, jobs are there.
Mm-hmm.
Jobs are there. Even we have artificial intelligence and, you know, mobile apps, many technological advancements coming up. I think there are jobs, but I think the way and the shade, the shape, the pattern of the jobs are changing.
Mm.
So how far we are equipping with that particular advancement is very important. Yes, robots are going to replace the humans, but I think India will see a little difference in the way people management, people, procuring, was there so okay. far. But recruiting people has been a very responsible duty of HR. Getting the right talent to the right job at the right time, at the right place, is very important.
Mm.
This is what we call this manpower planning. So we need to plan the manpower so that this manpower's talent is not exploited, nor it is, you know, it is to be used properly.
Mm.
It is to be utilized properly.
Mm.
So when this particular talent is inside the organization for a few years, either the employee will kind of shift job, or because of various other reasons, the company itself may try to lay off. So both ways happens. I think when we talk about this retention, there are various strategies that HR should come up, whether it is giving him or her the right place for exhibiting the talent.
Mm.
Number two, growth and opportunities. Until the development opportunities are there for the employee, the employee will face a little guilt in terms of living inside the organization.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it is about 10 hours, 11 hours the employee is spending time for the organization. So unless and until there are development, career development opportunities, it is difficult.
Mm.
Number three, we always talk about this compensation, the benefits part. So this particular compensation and benefit, giving the right package, the right benefits to the employee is very important. Number four, having fostering a proper organizational culture. This will also induce the employee to retain inside the organization. And number five would be having the proper culture, the DNA, setting the DNA, the policy making, the procedures inside the organization. If I join an organization, the first thing that I would see is the key principles, the core values that organization designs and maintains the employees. So these are few aspects that employees look for, and when these are there, I think retention is easy. When organizations try to take some important initiatives like mergers and acquisitions, retrenchments, layoffs, all these are big challenges for employees. So how do we handle it? That is very important. As an HR,
yeah.
I think bringing in the employees is as much as important as exiting the employee out. It is both important. I think the challenge for the HR is to make the employee exit with the most contented heart. He wouldn't be most fulfilled, but at least to an extent contented heart. That is very important.
So is that possible during layoffs?
Not really, it will not, because a person losing job is not that easy.
Mm.
But to an extent, the HRs should create an ambience, create a climate inside the employee, with the employee, such that, he is exiting for an important cause.
Okay. So far, I have been talking about recruitment, retention, attrition and layoff and the dimensions behind that. So, coming to the entry point, what should a fresher look for while taking up an offer?
Freshers, yes, beautiful question, because I love freshers. So, when we talk about freshers, yes, this is a more interesting and important topic for me, because I majorly focus on working with the freshers. Every year, so many n number of graduates are coming out of various colleges, and these freshers are a big talent pool for the nation. So these freshers, once they finish their graduation, UG, PG, their first step is to build a career. People are confused in terms of getting a job or building a career. I think people need to go for the second option. Rather than getting a job, build your career. That is what is important. And when people join organization, so what are the few important steps? One, do not use the company to just get salary, number one. Number two, don't play, trump cards with a, counter organization's salary. So, this organization is providing me this particular salary and this is, this is little lesser than, the other organization. These kind of replies from the candidate will create a different reputation about the candidate to the HR. Number three, building a career. We've been talking about building a career. It is advisable for the candidates to understand the industry which the organization is into and work on the organization's verticals, the industry that they are into, and the products and services that they are into. So when they understand the company as such, it is easy for them to relate themselves with the company. And when we talk about freshers joining a company, one, it is good for them to understand which position, which role and responsibility they are wanting to take up and where their career is going to shift in the next 5 years, next 10 years, what are they up to? So these are various things that the freshers should see. And next would be the freshers understanding themselves, their strengths, their limitations, and what would be the opportunities and threats that are in the society. The SWOT analysis should be done by every fresher so that they do some self-analysis and say, fine, this particular company is into this and taking up this role inside this organization will take me to the next level. So these are various things that the fresher should work on.
Okay. As you say, freshers should look into all these things while they take up an offer. Are these information readily provided to preempt them of such questions with HR?
No. See, that's not the HR's role.
Okay.
I think that's where we need to bridge the gap between the education system and the employment system.
Mm.
So nowadays, education system is far better than earlier, because colleges are taking a lot of attempts in terms of collaborating with the industrial experts, bringing about various entrepreneurs, subject matter experts into the institution so that the students get enough exposure to understand what's happening outside. Mm. So having these institutions doing this, I think this way of looking at the professional organizations from these candidates' point of view is changing.
Mm.
And there are various forums available in the society, professional forums who give enough knowledge. There are many seminars, conferences, many workshops happening outside. So these kind of learning and development space outside will definitely, should definitely make the student to understand what is happening. And when they are entering into the organization as a candidate to get recruited, they should be at least with some capacity inside so that they're career ready.
Yeah.
So we call it career ready programs, right?
Mm.
So career ready is not just joining the organization, but equipping ourselves, the candidate, equipping themselves with the right kind of attitude.
Okay, right kind of attitude as well as understanding the industry. Whichever they aspire to enter in.
Yeah.
So if that is there, they'll readily put up questions to know about all these aspects you have been talking about.
Exactly.
Great. You have been giving brilliant answers about what freshers should look for when they go for taking an offer. And now I'm going to the next end of the poll. It's about ageism, the new thing that is erupting through the job scape. That when people become aged, that is reaching 40 or beyond 40, people find it difficult to land in a job in the Western countries. What is the scenario in India and how to overcome this concept of ageism?
We always have this conflict, merit and seniority.
Mm.
So this is always there. It doesn't mean merit needs only for youngsters to go about, and seniority is only for so-called aged people. But it's not aged actually. I'm looking at them as a crystallized intelligence reservoir.
Mm.
Freshers, youngsters, yes, they have a lot of amazing talent, skills, intelligence, the energy level and the speed that they do in terms of taking up a job. But when we talk about ageism, it is the intelligence that drives to do or to complete a job successfully. The people who are say X or Y, probably Y also can be included in that. So Gen X or Gen Y, these people have abundant knowledge in terms of various decades of experience, and along with that various decades of exposures that they had.
Mm.
So because the organizational pattern, the industry revolution, the technology advancement have been different, has been evolving every decade, say. So these exposures are there with these aging people only. And these aging people may not take new set of intelligence, but the existing, the crystallized existing intelligence will drive them to do a job completely.
Mm.
So this is the difference, and I think aging people are important for every organization. Though after retirement, after they are 58 to 60 years of age, the amount of experience and exposure they have is important for every organization.
Mm.
And organizations do recruit people who are retired from army, navy, defense, from various setups. So they acquire people, right? So at the same time, even in government, private, public sector organizations who actually have their retired people can be absorbed, and their experience will definitely add value to their organization structure.
So your take is about ageism. Age is not a factor. So it's all about intelligence and experience. So when we talk about the word intelligence, there is a question of emotional intelligence, and that is drastically at two extremes when we compare aged or seasoned people with the youngsters or freshers. So wherein freshers should work on enhancing their emotional intelligence to be in a professional setup. So what's your point on this?
Emotional intelligence doesn't do anything with the age.
Mm-hmm.
It's about an individual. There are freshers who are emotionally strong and there are freshers who are emotionally weak. It depends on the maturity that they have, the background that they have been brought up, and the various exposures they have. So emotional intelligence may be strong with the aged people. It is strong, in fact, with the aged people. But when we try to compare, you know, the freshers and the aged people, it's totally the other way.
Mm.
When we say, you know, the pyramid, this is an inverted pyramid. When they have a lot of energy, their exposure, their maturity, you know, their professionalism, their kind of experience, you know, this pyramid is an inverted pyramid this side. So we cannot definitely compare. It is all individualistic basis.
Okay. So now moving on from your HR perspective, I came across your profile that you have been an advocate defending for sexual harassment in workplaces. So what is the reality of women's safety at workplace? What solutions would you suggest for women's safety at workplace?
Sexual harassment is there everywhere.
Hmm.
Whether it is in the workplace or in the schooling or in the colleges or in the society as such. The sexual harassment in the workplace is one important thing. Sexual harassment of women is in different notions. Certain things come up, certain things don't even come up. It is closed as such. And this needs to come out, and organizations are taking various measures.
Yeah.
Women are not only you know, physically harassed, but also verbally harassed. Women travel in the night shifts.
Mm.
Women come in the early in the mornings, by 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock also they come home. And there are many cab drivers who safely bring and people who don't even bring. So
yeah.
It varies. And in the restrooms, a lot of you know, harassments happen.
Mm.
We keep hearing a lot of such incidents. And HRs are nowadays setting up a proper structure for prevention of sexual harassment called POSH.
Mm.
And they have a proper committee to address these particular incidents confidentially.
Okay.
And at the same time genuinely, so that none of the employees are found guilt at the same time, not you know, left as such.
Mm-hmm. So as you talk about POSH and ICC, how structured it is in the Indian industry scenario?
I think by March 31st, every organization had to set up a proper POSH, prevention of sexual harassment, internal core committee team. So I think it has been extended to August also.
Okay.
And this ICC team is responsible to have a group of people both inside and outside, including women and men, so that these kind of incidents are genuinely found out, confidentially addressed, at the same time see to it doesn't repeat. So these things are properly addressed, and we also, you know, train every employee inside the organization what is about prevention of sexual harassment, what all comes under this sexual harassment, what doesn't come.
Okay.
And how is it to be dealt when you have a male workforce or a female workforce? How does it, you know, really work, and what are we up to? Why are we having this kind of structure so that, you know, certain things doesn't go wrong?
Okay.
So these are the various initiatives that this POSH committee does.
Okay. Is that under any particular law that this has come up?
Yes. You have this Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act.
So you have given a clear picture that it is well set up and it is taking proper shape.
Exactly. That's why we have some external members also, so that people advocate with legal people, you know, people who are from the social space, you know, will have it so that it's a group of people, you know, wholesomely included, so that things doesn't go wrong.
Throughout this interview, I've been listening to words like understanding, attitude, and accommodating, and harassment. All these are related to psychology, right? How people think, and behavior is an outcome of such thoughts. So what is the psychology of first impressions?
It was a beautiful topic that I recently came over, where I was invited as a panelist for this one particular topic. First impression is very important. As we always say, first impression is the best impression, that we always keep telling this. And this first impression is important for everybody.
Mm.
And I think this psychology of first impression is very apt to me, because whenever people look at me, they define me. Okay, so this I wanted to break it. When see, I have a challenge, and this challenge is either defined or sometimes it destroys me, and it is, there is a chance also for me to strengthen it. So I chose the third option. I wanted to strengthen this label and tell this outside world that first impression may sometimes go wrong, but I can make a lasting impression for that. Because the impression that we make with every person is the brand image of yourself, the reputation you carry, the brand, the, you are the brand ambassador for yourself, right? I feel I am the brand ambassador for myself. I think the image that you carry, the reputation that you carry outside world is very important. And people will tend to follow you. And how many people follow you is depending on your way of living. So this is what is important. The impression you make, not only on the first, but till the last.
So impressions should be natural that we make, and it should not be something put up or pretentious. That's what you say.
If, exactly.
You groom yourselves from within, your impression is going to last for long as a positive one, right?
First impression doesn't mean the way you showcase yourself. Showcasing ourselves are very important, but at the same time, how you feel inside, that is equally important.
Yeah. When you say making the first impression should not be pretentious and it should come from within, and it's not about how you show up yourself, it's all about what you feel inside. So what is conscious living?
Again, one beautiful topic that I like, and I actually quoted this particular topic when I wanted to address a group of women in a big company. Life is only once, and there are many hurdles, there are many happy moments. Life is full of many elements, and these elements are to either go inside or not to go inside. It is up to you. This conscious living is very, very important in terms of living your life to the benefit of yourself, to your people, and to the nation as such. That's what is conscious living.
Okay, and that was a great interview. And now we'll have a rapid fire round. I'll give you words for which you have to give short answers. Ability.
My ability is not having this in my ability.
Great. Problems.
How you perceive.
Okay, and the most liked book and the author.
I love people more than books.
Okay, your inspiration.
I feel inspiration is what you learn from each and everyone, and you cumulatively add, and you know, you bring your own image for yourself.
Okay, great. Thank you for being on our sets today.
Thank you.
Nice having a conversation with you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
And that was ICT Academy Dialogue with Raghavi Sindhil Kumar, the founder of the Headway Foundation. Stay tuned with us for more such episodes. Follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and Insta. Thank you.